William and Mary won the toss, elected to receive. That's no surprise. When they have won the toss this season, they have elected to start with the ball each time. Montana State ready to kick it off with Blake Lesner in blue. William and Mary back to receive in white. The Friday night lights are on in Bozeman. We are underway in our FCS quarterfinal. Slipping on the goal line. Did well to tumble forward past the 20. So the Tribe has started with the ball in all of one of their games this season. They've scored on 8 of their 11 opening drives. Big reason why, run game so good. Bronson Yoder leads the way.
Yeah, Bronson Yoder has been so much fun to watch as we prepare for this game, Jay. The last 5 games alone, 522 yards and 7 touchdowns. We talked a lot about Darius Wilson there in the open, but they also rely heavily on this ground attack.
It's going to be a heavy dose of the ground game for both teams tonight. They go right to Yoder, banged at the line of scrimmage, fell forward for a gain of 1.
Yeah, both these teams near the tops in the FCS with their rushing attacks. Montana State 2nd in the country, William and Mary 4th. Something's going to have to give tonight.
Now, William and Mary has already set a school record for rushing yards on the season. Let's see if they can establish that run. Now, Wilson throwing on 2nd down, and he bounces it incomplete.
You know, the one thing, Jay, that I think is going to be a factor in this game, especially with the passing game, and we saw this a lot in the warm-ups, the footing, especially near the sidelines. They've had a lot of storms that have come through Bozeman over the last couple of weeks. You can see the snow piles on the sidelines. It's extremely icy right near the sidelines, especially around the end zones.
What an awesome atmosphere, getting loud early for a 3rd and 9. Yoder bottled up at the line of scrimmage, trying to drag forward. He's gang tackled by a blue wall. Ben Seymour got there first.
Yeah, Ben Seymour just knifes in here, pretty much unblocked. He does a great job stopping this for no gain. You'll see 98. Top of your screen, he is unblocked. And a great job there finishing off the play. Iden helping out as well.
Will Whitehurst sends it soaring. Taco Dowler, the freshman, dangerous return man, tries to turn the corner. There's a flag down at the 28-yard line.
Kevin Jarrell with the stop for the Tribe.
We'll hear from Andrew Special, our head referee for the first time tonight.
And now another flag comes in here over on the Montana State sidelines from the head coach. They could be really backed up here, Jay.
And obviously, you want your players to be playing with emotion, right?
No question, yeah.
It's a playoff game. This place is rocking, but you want to keep that emotion in check.
Yeah, especially here to start this drive. And I think you may have a personal foul tacked on. Hard to hear the official, Jay, but I think it was just a sideline warning there on Montana State, so no harm, no foul there, but they're still very upset with the holding call on the punt return.
There's
Let's talk a little bit
Brent
about Tommy
Vegan.
Malott there,
yeah.
Jay Alter.
The pride of Butte, America, mining city about 90 miles from here, home to the richest hill on earth, and Bobcats fans, they're hoping they strike gold with touchdown Tommy tonight.
Yeah, they're hoping we're calling touchdown Tommy a lot this evening because this guy has been so great. Really took on the starting quarterback job a season ago, helped lead them to a national championship run. Unfortunately, he was injured in that ball game early against NDSU.
Elijah Elliott starts in the backfield, gets the carry, hit at the line of scrimmage. Both front sevens getting a really good push to start this game. Isaiah Jones shot out of a cannon to make that stop.
Boy, Jones just appeared so quickly in the backfield. Just lucky to get back to the line of scrimmage and gain maybe a yard.
Now we told you that the Bobcats run that two quarterback system, but it's Tommy Mellott who gets that first series.
Oh, and they'll rotate within series as well.
They'll even put them on the field at the same time.
Yes, they do.
Unique challenge for a defense to scout against. Back to the run game. Two tackles broken. Spinning. Elliott trying to churn those legs before he's wrestled down. Gain of six.
Bassant does a good job first to get a hand on the running back and then allows the rest of the Tribe defenders, including John Pius, their CAA Defensive Player of the Year, number eight. Be talking about him all night.
Third and three. Isaiah Afonso checks into the backfield. Number two rusher in the history of Montana State. He missed the entire regular season rehabbing from a knee surgery. He's back for the postseason. Gets the carry on a third and three, and he is driven back short of the first down. Kevin Jarrell, excellent tackle to prevent the Bobcats from moving the chains.
Well, this is just a great job by number 19, Kevin Jarrell. They call him the big backer, and you can see why. 6'1", 250. Watch 19 right here. Just get in there, and that's a difficult tackle to make. To stand up Ifonse in the backfield for no gain, and both these teams early three and outs.
We told you it was going to be the ground game. Defenses were ready for it, and they've stood tall through the opening series. Kalen Newton back to receive, does not call for the fair catch, loses his footing. Great special teams play, Montana State, to keep Kalen Newton in check. We are scoreless to start in Bozeman. Just getting started, some FCS quarterfinal action after dark. This week, the Montana State community mourning the death of legendary Bobcats head coach Sonny Holland. His statue sits right outside Bobcat Stadium. There's the Montana State coaches and players paying tribute before they took the field tonight. Holland's two daughters here as well. Holland coached the Cats in the 1970s, won the 1976 Division II championship. There's the statue right there. Passed away this past Sunday. And all the players said they're playing with Coach Holland on their mind tonight. Movement. Three flags coming out before the snap.
Full start. Offense number 61. 5-yard penalty. First down.
William and Mary backed up 5 yards towards the Sonny Holland end zone, where they are loud and proud for their former head coach. Helped set the standard here for Bobcats football. His legacy lives on with big games like tonight. First and 15 after the false start. Trying to get Bronson Yoder going. Slips a couple of tackles. He's really tough to bring down. Great leader, Mike London told us, every rep in practice, he is full speed. So when it comes to game day, he's just doing more of the same.
Oh, no doubt. And listen, this offensive line has just gotten better and better as the season's gone on. Gets a great block there from Charles Grant, number 60, to help him get a couple of extra yards. And you know, this offensive line, they had to replace four starters, Jay, from a season ago. Only one starter back, that's the right tackle, Colby Swordstall.
Got about half of it back. Sets up a second and eight. Play action, rolling left. Wilson on the run, wrapped up. And that's Callahan O'Reilly, the senior Bozeman native, born and bred in this town, making a big play in a playoff game.
Yeah, and he is as tough as anybody, especially from that linebacker position, to run this down. And remember, Darius Wilson's a lefty, so they'll roll him out a lot to that left side. And there is O'Reilly, making a big-time stop to set up a third and 10.
Big shoes to fill. Followed a second-round pick in the NFL draft, Troy Anderson, who's playing for the Atlanta Falcons right now. Third and 10. Pressure comes. Wilson steps up. Batted down. Ty Okada there again. But this Bobcats defense is dialed in. They've forced back-to-back three and outs.
In those situations, third and long, that's where they're going to bring pressure. And the Bobcats bring a blitz right up the middle with O'Reilly. And it's kind of a twist coming around as well. And then there's just nowhere for Wilson to go. He is very lucky that Okada did not intercept that. He could have taken that back to the house.
Almost a blocked punt.
I think he may have got a piece.
Yeah. Could have been a whole lot worse, though. Will Whitehurst only goes for 27 yards.
And, Jay, guess who I think was on that? I think that might have been Ifonse, the running back, who may have got a piece of that.
There's Mike London, who's come into William & Mary, done such a tremendous job. Remember, he's used to FCS football, won the FCS championship in 2008 with Richmond. Now he finds himself back in an FCS quarterfinal. Great field position for Montana State. They stick with Tommy Mellott at quarterback. Starting in Tribe territory, Mellott pulls it out, runs forward for a gain of three.
Tommy Mellott with the quarterback keeper.
You know, what's funny about this two quarterback system, Dustin, is usually when we see it, there's one passing quarterback, one running quarterback. These guys run about the same, pass about the same.
Yeah, Mellott's thrown for 1,400 yards. Chambers, 584, and eight touchdowns on the season, both of them. I mean, last week alone, Chambers only threw two passes, but they were both touchdowns.
We've yet to see Sean Chambers tonight. Mellott rolling left. Pressure coming. Tries to turn the corner and is bounced out of bounds. And when you go out of bounds, you're going to slide. That's a sheet of ice. They've done a great job clearing the field of snow, but it is really icy on those sidelines.
And you see a great job here by the Tribe defense, just containing Sting, discipline with their eyes and staying at home. And then Braden Stabe kind of forces him out of bounds.
We've got a lot of brave young men out there, as we see Chambers going sleeveless. A lot of these players going sleeveless for under 20-degree weather.
We had a great opportunity to sit down with some of these young men from Montana State yesterday afternoon, and I asked them if they're going to wear sleeves or not, and they said, nah, they're going sleeveless.
Braver than Bozeman you or
tough.
Me. Mellott slings it incomplete, way over the head of Willie Patterson.
So that, Jay, I mean, look at Bryce Layton, the punter. He had one punt in the last three games. Now two punts here in the first quarter.
He went 15 straight quarters, 25 straight drives, without punting. And now
they just move up and down the field. And listen, here's the thing about the FCS playoffs. When you get to the quarterfinals and semifinals, you just don't necessarily know how teams are going to stack up when you've got teams from different conferences.
Layton high in the air. Kalen Newton lets it bounce, and it rolls into the end zone for a touchback. Two teams with high-powered offenses, Dustin, but it's the defense that has stolen this first quarter. Knotted at zeros, getting started. Darius Wilson on the field when we come back. Beautiful sunset in Bozeman, Montana. This is gorgeous country out here. Dustin Fox, Jay Alter with you. We allegedly have a Heisman winner in the house. Cam Newton here to root on his brother, Kalen Newton, who is a wide receiver for William & Mary, top target number three in white.
Gotta say, Jay, first trip to Montana, and this is the motherland, God's country out here. Love it.
Still trying to get that run game established. Bronson Yoder hasn't had a lot of success tonight.
You look at both teams to start this game, Jay. Four drives, four three and outs, 13 total yards, and no first downs for two of the top offenses in the entire country. I was just telling you during the break, Jay, I think we've just got two really good football teams and two really good defenses coming in here. It's going to be a slugfest in 15-degree weather.
Would you like to see William & Mary try and air it out some?
I think you're going to have to at some point. I think there's some opportunities on the outside.
Stick with the ground game. Stood up at the line of scrimmage. Sebastian Valdez swallowed up Yoder. Let's check in with Lauren Sisler on the sidelines.
Hey, you guys talk about Cam Newton. He's been at every single William & Mary football game, home and away, leading the chants, bringing the energy. Cam Newton has nothing but pride for his younger brother and the hard work he's put in through the entire college football season and his football career. And he's here to see him to the finish line. And hopefully that's not tonight, my friends.
I love that hat. Always fashionable. Braving the elements, all orange. And then that's not exactly a cowboy hat, is it, partner?
It's cooler than ours.
Wilson right on the money and dropped. Malachi Emo could not hold on. He would have picked up the first down. Instead, a punt.
Again, I think the players, especially for William & Mary, they're not used to these conditions. And when I say conditions, not just the cold, Jay, but the turf. And when you're out there trying to cut, you're thinking a lot about not necessarily just catching the football, but keeping your feet on the turf and keeping in bounds. And then the fifth punt of the game.
Whitehurst this time drives it cleanly. And it bounces, takes a very friendly William & Mary roll out of bounds.
Whitehurst punt goes down to the 30-yard line.
Lauren, how are the conditions down there?
Yeah, Dustin makes a good point. Let me tell you, there is definitely ice and snow in the turf, and I realize this turf has, like, the rubber beads, but I ain't feeling any of those rubber beads right now, y'all. It is slick. As I was walking across, it was like ice skating, and I thought to myself, how are these guys going to cut in these kind of conditions? But, you know, this William & Mary football team said they're not going to make excuses. They try to get acclimated to the cold weather, obviously, the conditions. Playing late at night, that's why they came on Wednesday, so... They're out here taking full advantage of this. Of course, Montana State, they're used to it. So,
only 20 total yards of offense from both of these teams combined. And Dustin, these are two of the best offenses, most prolific offenses throughout the regular season at the FCS level.
Yeah, I mean, especially Montana State. They come in scoring 44 points a game. You know, you look at the last few weeks, I mean, what they've been able to do. We talked about the fact they've only punted one time in the last three games. Now, during those three games, they had 19 touchdowns, 9 field goals. They were unstoppable.
Offensive coordinator Taylor Housewright, he's used to putting up touchdowns, and they've been forced to punt twice. Finally breaking free, Isaiah Fonse into the secondary, and we've got our first down of the game. Gain of 20.
And this fan base went nuts last week when Ifonse got his first carry. That's a great run. You talked about it, Jay. This guy's been through so much adversity over the last three seasons, multiple knee injuries, has not played a snap until last week in the second round of the FCS playoffs.
Ifonse again, shedding tacklers. Bounced out of the 20-yard line, gain of 25. That's 45 yards on two carries on this drive.
And we talked yesterday with Brent Vegan, the head coach at Montana State, and he said in this game, you're going to see a lot more carries for Ifonse, who had just 10 carries a week ago but did have 91 yards. And this may be the start that the Bobcats need to get going here offensively.
Into the red zone for the first time tonight. Ifonse out of the game, and said it's Elijah Elliott. He's got the same success. Finally getting a push up front, and the Bobcats backfield starting to capitalize.
You know, they may have found something off that left side. Back-to-back runs, getting big holes. That offensive line led by their center, Justice Perkins.
William & Mary not fooled, and that'll set up a third and four after a loss of two.
Yeah, great job by the Tribe there to not be fooled. I'm looking at the running back there, and I'm thinking Elliott's just going to walk into the end zone. Instead, Malott keeps it. An excellent job by Ty Freeland, the safety there, staying home, and now we're going to get Sean Chambers, looks like, coming to the ballgame.
The transfer from Wyoming, his first snap of the night, comes at a third and three in the red zone.
And Derek Snell, their tight end, is in at fullback.
Ifonse bulldozed in the backfield. Braden Stabe shot right in there. And now Montana State forced to send the field goal unit out. Feels like another missed opportunity.
Well, it definitely does feel like a missed opportunity for the Bobcats. And, you know, last week against Weber State, they had to settle four times for field goals inside the red zone. But a good stop by the Tribe.
Blake Lesner from 30. And the sophomore opens the scoring. Nice hold by the William & Mary defense, though, after Ifonse had 45 yards on two carries.
Well, this prolific offensive attack finally gets going, but William & Mary gets the stop. 3-0 Bobcats from Bozeman.
Our FCS quarterfinal continues from Bozeman. North Dakota State beating Samford earlier tonight. Montana State, William & Mary, our 4-5 game. Who is going to book a spot in that semifinal? Take on the winner of South Dakota State and Holy Cross. That is tomorrow, noon Eastern time on ESPN. Now, it's not often you have a former NFL MVP at an FCS playoff game. Cam Newton, a.k.a. William & Mary superfan. He has not missed a game all season long, rooting off his younger brother, Kalen Newton, who was a former quarterback at one point, following in his brother's footsteps. Now he's transferred and been a wide receiver. He got the Heisman Trophy ceremony tomorrow night. Cam Newton knows what winning a Heisman is like. What a prolific player. And now, older brother and super fan, Dustin.
I love it, man. This guy comes to every game, as you guys have been talking about it. Braving the elements in the teens here at Bozeman, and it's only going to get colder as we go throughout the night.
And there's younger brother, Kalen. What a journey.
Yeah.
He starts at Howard as a quarterback, then transfers to Auburn. The Tigers convert him to wide receiver. And now it is sixth and final season, using the COVID year to play for Mike London, who he played for under London at Howard. And he's making a real impact on this team, both with leadership, but he's also the leading receiver.
He does everything. I mean, he'll play special teams. He'll run down on kickoff, punt return, whatever they ask of him to do. Just enjoying this final season.
Wilson, pump fake, now scrambles. Darius Wilson showing some footwork, pushing that pile, churning the legs forward. Gain of 9. Tough kid out of the Bronx, New York City.
It was funny, Mike London, the head coach at William & Mary, was talking about the weather conditions. And he said, yeah, he's a Bronx kid. He's used to these conditions. Jay, you're an East Coaster.
Yeah.
Is it quite as cold on the East
it's
Coast?
It's a little different out here. The wind, you don't get a lot of that in the Bronx.
A little balmy here.
Second and one.
This guy's tough, man. Oh, my goodness.
We've got shirtless Bobcat fans here in Bozeman. Braver than Dustin. Blown up in the backfield. Loss of 4. Ty Okada shot in there, the safety. Bronson Yoder, nothing he could do.
I love watching Ty Okada. This guy is just so tremendous, athletic. Knife's in there. They put him all over the field, Jay's the nickelback, right? So he can cover, but he can also blitz off the edge. Does a great job making that stop in the backfield, putting William & Mary in a third and long.
A little undersized at 5'11", 200, but his head coach, Brent Vegan, said he deserves a shot at the next level.
No question.
Just a great football player. Third and 5, Wilson slings it. Gain of 4, needed 5. Drayshawn Kendrick stopped just short. What do you do here, Dustin?
That's a great question. I think because of the way this game has started, defensive struggle, I think you probably punt the football.
Yeah, Mike London decided to play the field position battle. You're only at a 33-yard line. That'd be a gutsy call. Now, if we're sitting here in the fourth quarter.
it depends on the situation of the game. I think it's early enough where you rely on this defense. Oh, great roll.
Bounce right past Taco Dowler and down inside the 20. Punt of 49 yards, a lot of that off the bounce.
So we'll see Tommy Malott come back out here as they put Chambers in briefly on that last drive. And, of course, Isaiah Ifanse, their tailback, who really got things going on that last drive with those two breakout runs back in here at running back. And again, Jay, a couple, what's he have, about three, four carries already? He only had 10 last week. I think we'll see him get upwards of 15, 20 carries in this game.
Again, last week was his first start of the season. Here's Ifanse finding the hole again. He's just bouncing off William and Mary defenders. Such a hard runner. You would never know he missed the entire regular season, Dustin.
Yeah, he takes Malcolm Spencer for a ride. Number five, you'll see right here, five in white. We'll try to make this tackle in the open field and gets a little bit of a ride from Ifanse.
Malott kept it, throws, it's caught. Trey and Pickering, plenty of room to run, shoved out of bounds. Big time pickup, picking out the tight end into Tribe territory.
And again, you can see that footing. Malcolm Spencer probably could have come up and tried to make this tackle sooner, but he's just trying to get his feet settled on that turf, and it allows Pickering to get the extra maybe 15 yards there.
Gain of 42, biggest play of the night for either team. A little more than 35 seconds left of this opening quarter. Ifanse, right up the gut.
I guess when you look at it like this, as quickly as the Cats have gone down the field, maybe you would have gone for it if you're William and Mary on that fourth and one. Ifanse's, he's fun to watch. It's amazing. You know, he tore his PCL back in 2019, Jay. Didn't play in 2020. And then comes back in 2021 and hurts his other knee. And so he has to have two operations after the 21 season.
Malott on the move, turns the corner into the end zone. Touchdown, Tommy Malott. On the final play of the first quarter, the sophomore from Butte strikes for Montana State.
And this is where he's so dangerous. It's inside the red zone. You can see his speed getting on the outside. And I think just now, wearing down this William and Mary defense, you get extra bodies on the outside. What a great block by JT Reed, the left guard. And let's go ice skating. I'm going to go for a ride.
So slippery once you hit the sidelines. Malott sticks the landing, though. And Montana State finishes this first quarter with a bang.
The Bobcats finally get something going, finding the end zone. Touchdown, Tommy. Quarterback sweep on the outside, and like we said, let's go skating.
Kevin, we're having a blast in Bozeman. Dustin Fox, Lauren Sisler, Jay Alter with you. Start of the second quarter of our FCS quarterfinal, the road to the FCS championship. Usually it does go through North Dakota State, if recent history or the last decade tells us anything.
We'll find out what happens tomorrow. Holy cross, what a great story they've been this season, Jay, as they're going to be in Brookings taking on the Jackrabbits.
Montana State scored on the final play of the first quarter. Tommy Malott, they call him Touchdown Tommy, and he delivered for him. What can William and Mary do, Dustin, to spark this offense to life? Because it's a high-powered offense. We expected a lot of scoring in this game, yeah. But Darius Wilson and company, they haven't gotten going.
Well, Kendrick and Newton are two talented wide receivers on the outside. The one thing, you know, that I took away as I prep for this game is I think Montana State could be vulnerable on the outside. They've given up some big plays this year. Their pass defense, you know, they give up about 250 yards a game through the air. And early in the season, there were huge chunk plays against their secondary. Heck, Northern Arizona threw for 452. Now, I know the field conditions are not great, but if you try a couple go balls, I think you would serve well to the Tribe.
The run game's just not working.
No, there's nowhere to go. This Bobcats defense in the middle of that defense specifically. You know, it all starts with Sebastian Valdez, 95, Blake Schmidt and company. They've got some dudes on that Bobcat defense.
I'll tell you who really jumps out to me, number 47 in blue.
Yeah.
Callahan O'Reilly.
Yeah, but there's Valdez. I mean, this guy, yeah. He put on 20 pounds, Jay, this offseason. plays that three technique position, which means you got to take on double teams. You got to do a great job in the run game. It's a selfless position, and he is very selfless on that defense.
Malachi Emo wrapped up, ankle tackled. Danny Uru Ilakepa, the sophomore from Washington.
It just seems like every time the Tribe had the football, they're in third and seven or longer. Obvious passing situations. And again, Willie Matt Garza, who's back this week after serving a suspension a week ago, defensive coordinator for the Bobcats, he's going to dial up pressure here. He knows that they're in a passing situation.
0 for 4 on third down. William and Mary desperate for a first down. Third and seven. Wilson sandwiched in the backfield. Clean pocket for now. Starting to collapse. Throws on the run. Incomplete. Threw it behind Kendrick. And the Tribe offense continues to struggle. This is a team that ranked 54 points up on Gardner-Webb just 6 days ago. Mike London has to be thinking, is this the same offense we've seen all season?
Well, I mean, part of that, Jay, was, you know, that was like the perfect storm, too, for William and Mary. They had six takeaways in that game that led to a lot of those, you know, points off of turnovers. But you're right. I mean, that was probably their best performance of the season, and no points so far early in this game for the Tribe.
The head coach, Mike London, told us, we're playing our best football at the right time. Have yet to see that today. Dowler lost his footing, just slipped at the 45-yard line. There's a flag down at the opposite 40.
The initial ruling is it's going to be on William and Mary, which would be declined. They got excellent field position off the punt return.
Illegal formation, number seven for the defense, aligned over the center. That five-yard penalty will be enforced from the previous spot. Fourth down.
Yeah, I'd repunt it then. I was confused. He saw the illegal formation. Typically, that's on an offense. With the way the punt return, you know, got him out near midfield, this is a good decision to come back out and punt it again.
So Brent Vegan, special team unit, has to run back out there. 23-4 record since he's taken the reins here at Bozeman. Terrific pedigree, started his career at North Dakota State, helped them start the dynasty, won their first three championships, then went to Wyoming, where he was the quarterback's coach and co-offensive coordinator, and now running his own program for the first time. Got all the way to the FCS championship in year number one, trying to get back there in his second season. A booming punt sends Dowler all the way back to the 16-yard line. Two broken tackles. Montana State winning the special teams battle so far tonight. Got a 10-0 lead, and their offense back on the field. Kick off your Week 14 NFL Sunday, 10 a.m. Eastern time, with the Countdown crew on ESPN and the ESPN app. They'll have everything you need to know, taking you right up to kickoff.
I believe the crowd tonight, Jay.
Awesome atmosphere.
Nearly capacity.
Yeah.
Here in Bozeman, these fans braving the element.
They've been loud, proud. The Bobcats have given them plenty to shout about so far. Malott taking a shot on first down. Incomplete. Willie Patterson trying to haul it in with one hand.
That would have been an amazing catch by Patterson on the outside. Jalen Jones, the top freshman in the CAA, the corner on the outside, does a good job, gets his head turned around. That football's thrown in the perfect spot, nearly a SportsCenter top 10 catch by Willie Patterson. Man, if he could have hauled this one in.
Second and 10 after the incompletion. Montana State moving the ball a lot better on the last two drives. Isaiah Fonse, huge hole, and he runs right through it. Isaiah Fonse is gone. Touchdown, Montana State. 68 yards to the house.
Isaiah Fonzie with the run. Almost makes it to the locker room.
And on that run, Isaiah Afonso becomes the leading rusher in Montana State football history.
Watch Jacob Kettle, 75, gets a great block on the inside that helps spring Afonso. And then again, for a guy who's battled multiple knee surgeries, playing with a brace shows off the speed that he has. And you pointed it out, the all-time leader now in Bobcat history.
Burst onto the scene as a freshman. The first Bobcat with more than 1,000 yards rushing in his first year. Now up to 3,690 yards. Missed the entire regular season, back last week for the first time. Steps on the gas, and now he's the leading rusher in Montana State football history. FCS quarterfinal continues from Bozeman, and we have history. Isaiah Afonso, the new school record with 3,690 rush yards, and appropriately, Dustin, he sets it, scoring a touchdown.
Yeah, no doubt. This guy, you know, last season helped lead them all the way to the national championship. And, you know, Jay, we were talking with some of the players here at Montana State yesterday. I asked them, is there some unfinished business? Is this like a situation where you guys talk about, hey, we want to get back there and have a little redemption from that national championship? They said there's no question that that is their motivation at this point in time in the season. Got to take it one game at a time still. They're off to a really good start here in the quarters.
JT Mayo on the return. Flies past the 25-yard line.
And I'll tell you, Jay, the defense for William and Mary, they've got to be gassed. Because their offense, they only have 25 yards of total offense so far in the game. That's what I'm saying. They've been on the field the entire first half. And remember, this is elevation here. Not just cold, but we're talking near 5,000 feet of elevation.
How does that affect you as a player?
Winds you. Makes you really tired. I played in Denver in the NFL one time. I remember running down on kickoff. It felt like I played 15 snaps in one play. It's nothing you really can prepare for until you get out there and actually participate.
He's Dustin Fox. I'm Jay Alter. Lauren Sisler down on the sidelines. William and Mary down 17-0. They're a long way from home. 150 miles away from home.
Darius Wilson with the run.
Positive yards on first down. Gain of 5 for Darius Wilson. How do you even start the comeback here when you haven't been able to get anything going, Dustin?
I think you got to try to get something going through the air on early downs. I mean, every time they get the football, they're trying to run on first and second down, and they're getting no gain. So then you're in 3rd and 7+. And then that allows the Bobcats defense to tee off.
Flag thrown before the snap.
Offside, defense, number 96. 5-yard penalty results the first down.
Well, it comes by way of a penalty, but that is the first down of the game for William and Mary. Baby steps.
You take it one first down at a time at this point. You'll take it any way you can get it. You need something. Something positive to happen here for the Tribe. At least get a couple first downs to keep your
string them together.
Yeah. Get your defense a rest.
Here's Bronson Yoder. Bottled up again. Just running into a blue wall. William and Mary wants a flag for unsportsmanlike conduct. Not going to get one.
And every yard for William and Mary has been so difficult. You can see the rotation. Bobcat's going to rotate that entire defensive line here on second and about 8.
They've got so much depth on defense, too.
Oh, no question, especially up front.
2nd and 8 for Darius Wilson. He's just 1 of 5 through the air. Going to take a shot here. Who's open? Wilson throws way incomplete, looking for the tight end, Lachlan Pitts, but nowhere near him.
And Darius Wilson just doesn't quite look comfortable I'm not sure if it's the conditions, if it's the weather, if it's the field, but just not the same player we saw a week ago. Just doesn't look completely settled in and dialed into this game.
Still looking for that spark offensively. Only takes one play, but they've yet to get it. 0-for-5 on third down tonight. Playing a dialed-in defense. Wilson. Pressure coming. Wilson throws it. He's hit. Completes the pass. There's a flag down at the 29-yard line. Blake Schmidt was the one bearing down on Wilson.
They're going to get a hold on Swordstall on the holding right side.
Offense number 65. Penalties declined. The result of a play, fourth down.
0-for-6 on third down now, Dustin.
Just an awful way to start this game. See the great pressure by Blake Schmidt, 92, getting in there, working against the right tackle, Colby Swordstall.
If for William and Mary, this is unfamiliar territory. 11-1 season, tied their school record for most wins already. They have not lost since September 24th. And they've won a lot of those games comfortably as well. Now down 17-0 on the back foot here in Bozeman. The Tribe trying to find something on the road. They've dug themselves quite a hole. The Bobcats rolling in Bozeman.
Well, a heck of a run there by Marcus Fulcher from Sac State. They're on top 14-7 from Sacramento. Had a chance to cover them earlier this season. That's a really talented squad as you get a look at the brackets.
Yeah, they're trying to battle into playing North Dakota State in the semifinals. The winner of our game here in Bozeman will take on the winner of South Dakota State Holy Cross. That game tomorrow on ESPN, noon Eastern time. A little lopsided so far. Montana State back out onto the field with a 17-0 lead. They are averaging more than 10 yards a play. Play action. Malott. Pump fake. Now runs. Throws. It's caught. Willie Patterson makes the grab after a lot of improvisation from Tommy Malott.
Really good job by Patterson on the outside, knowing what to do in the scramble drill. You'll see him kind of runs a little bit of a double move, trying to run like a pick on the wheel route, and then he just turns this into like a triple move route, comes back to the football, and takes a shot.
Montana State's first two drives, 2 3-and-outs, 6 plays, 10 yards. Since then, 3 drives, 13 plays, 200 and 8 yards, 17 points, Dustin. They have hit another gear here.
Ryan Poole comes up and delivers the blow to Afonso. They're going to need more tackles like that because you hit on it there, Jay. This offense, after the first couple of drives, it just seems like they're just now starting to wear out the Tribe.
Now they are rolling. Isaiah Afonso missed the entire regular season, came back last week against Weber State tonight. 9 carries, 143 yards. He set the school record. Malott, what's he going to do here? Ends up sacked.
Tommy Malott, the quarterback keeper.
Loss of 4, exactly what William and Mary needed.
Yeah, you'll watch Pius here on the outside. Number 8 does a good job working inside, then outside. Comes down the line. Gets a little help from Isaiah Jones here as well, as they both help get Malott to the ground.
Pius, the CAA Defensive Player of the Year.
He's really turned into a heck of a pass rusher. Came in at about 190, has put on 30 pounds of muscle since, and turned into one of the better players in the country.
At Yorktown High School, he actually played some corner. That's
well,
how small he was, yeah. Afonso hard running again, churning those legs.
And he's going to get the first down.
Picks up the first down with that extra effort. Wow.
Wow, that's just devastating to a defense. You've got him backed up, third and long. And it was just a great push here by that offensive line. Then they just keep pushing Afonso from behind. As you see, Justice Perkins, 65, comes in and pushes Afonso.
He was stopped short.
He would have
been stopped
short.
On a third and 8,
yeah.
And instead, The extra effort moves the chains. William and Mary's coaching staff on the field here. Some confusion over on the Tribe sideline. Mike London is furious. No clue what he could be upset about other than his own defense allowing that third and eight.
Well, the officials didn't have anything to do with that.
First and 10. Montana State rolling in this second quarter. Midway through it. Malott on the run. Huge hole, Tommy Malott inside the 30. Spun down after a big gain of 24.
And William and Mary, they just don't know which way it's going to come from, because they'll put Derek Snell, the tight end number eight in the backfield, and he's going to be the lead blocker on the outside. And they've got space, but then, of course, Malott just cuts it up in the middle. And those gaps in a defense, that's where Malott's going to take advantage.
How good has his offensive line been on the last few drives?
Just absolutely incredible. You know, we were talking with Brent Vegan, and I said, who's kind of the star on that offensive line? He's like, he's got a bunch of really good players that play well together.
Only a gain of two. Derek Snell, the tight end, getting in on the rushing game. He does it all.
He really does.
Swiss Army knife for Montana State.
Yeah, Coach Vegan was saying he may be the best player they've got on their offense. They try to get the football in his hands in a variety of ways. They'll put him in the backfield. They'll split him out wide. They'll put him in line. He's an excellent blocker as well.
College Game Day was here a few weeks ago for the Cat Grizz game.
Yeah.
What an awesome scene that
great
was
scene
here in Bozeman. Pat McAfee called Derek Snell the Alaskan Assassin.
What a nickname. Love it. Very fitting.
Such a great teammate. Brent Vegan telling us he'll do whatever we need him to do. Malott hit as he throws. Double coverage. It's intercepted. William and Mary have it with Malcolm Spencer, but there's a flag down. This interception could very well be negated.
I think they may get pass interference here on the outside, but what an effort by number five, Malcolm Spencer, to go up and catch that football.
Pass interference, defense, number 35. 15-yard penalty in the previous spot, automatic, first down.
So wave off the touchdown. Mike London, he's been furious all drive. Now he's really letting the officials have it.
And
Tommy Malott stays on the field.
Could have been the stop this defense needed. And you can see 35, Quinn Osborne all over Derek Snell down the field. Malcolm Spencer, he didn't need the help. He was in position to make this play. But it's the right call.
Mike London furious over on that Tribe sideline. And both quarterbacks are in for Montana State. This is the unique two-quarterback system where they're both on the field. Malott on the left hip of Chambers. He dives forward. Only a gain of one for the transfer from Wyoming. Haven't seen a lot of Sean Chambers in this first half. He came by way of Wyoming. He followed Brent Vegan, who recruited him out there. Then Vegan, who was his position coach, takes the head coaching job. Chambers decides to follow.
Yeah, he'll stay in the game here with Tommy Malott. Some here in Bozeman have coined Sean Chambers as Big Cat and Tommy Malott as Little Cat. I think it's fitting.
And when they're both lined up there in the backfield with Afonso, who's going to get the ball? All three of them can beat you. Malott, quarterback keeper, up the middle and in. Touchdown, Tommy Malott scores his second of the night. Caps off an eight-play, 74-yard drive, and it's all Bobcats in this quarterfinal.
Now, these fans are loving it here in Bozeman, and I think this was a broken play. Malott's looking to, he's like, who am I going to fake the RPO to? No one's there, and he just takes off up the middle. and there's nobody there for William and Mary. Eight plays, 74 yards. And boy, at this point, if you're William and Mary, you better get something going here before halftime.
William and Mary thought they had an interception, thought they had a turnover. Pass interference negated the turnover, and instead, Tommy Malak
illegal formation for a touchdown. Number nine for the defense, lined up over the snapper. Pilly's good, no good.
Well, the Tribe, they're getting used to touchdown Tommy, his second touchdown run of the day. 24-0 from Bozeman.
Back here in beautiful Bozeman, gorgeous country, as V-Week continues on ESPN when we partner with the V Foundation to highlight the urgent need for cancer research. This is game-changing research that really does help save lives. You can join the fight against cancer by visiting v.org/donate. 100% of your donation goes directly to cancer research. So many families every day affected by cancer. I was reminded of that yesterday on my flight into Bozeman. Met retired Marine Colonel Eric Hastings. Wonderful conversation with the Bobcat season ticket holder, quarterback club member. At the end of our conversation, he told us that he lost his wife, Jean, to cancer last year after a six-year battle. Far too often, everywhere you look, someone close to you is battling, and that's why V-Week is here. Now, William and Mary back onto the field in a 24-0 hole. Set a school record in rush yards, and yet only 1.5 yards per play, 27 total yards, 24 of them on the ground. Wilson pitches it, trying to get something going in the ground game. That's a first down, much needed. Malachi Emo, who missed last week's game against Gardner-Webb, providing a spark off the bench tonight.
Yeah, the best run so far, the speed option here by Wilson on the outside, reads the edge man of the line of scrimmage. It's a good job picking up that first down, then takes a little slide inside the Bobcat sideline there.
Wilson throws to the tight end, Pitts, barreling forward, back-to-back first down pickups, gain of 14. This is the first time tonight William and Mary has picked up two first downs on one drive.
It's a cool little play on the outside there to Pitts. Might have been a backwards pass. It was hard to see.
Yeah, I think it was.
I think it was. And it was very close to being across the line of scrimmage, but that's a...
Wouldn't have mattered if it was gone behind.
No, great play design.
First and 10, knocking on the doorstep of Bobcat territory for the first time tonight. Emo stays in the game in the backfield. Wilson flips it to the sophomore, hesitates and swallowed up. And he slips again, going out of bounds. Ben Seymour got there first for the Cats.
Boy, how fast is this Bobcats defense? They just swarm to the football, and it's got to be frustrating for Mike London and his staff. They just can't seem to get anything going up the middle. They try to get on the perimeter, and then everywhere you look, you see a blue jersey.
I mean, these are the Colonial champs. They're enjoying one of their best seasons in school history. They've been dominating in the run game. Eight-game winning streak, and yet they have got nothing going in this first half. A dialed-in Montana State defense. Yoder trying to push that pile. There hasn't been much to cheer about for Cam Newton, older brother of Kalen Newton. That's how he's known for William and Mary, folks, right? He's not the NFL MVP, Heisman Trophy winner. He's Kalen's older brother and super fan of this Tribe team, but...
And super supportive of his younger brother, who was having himself a nice season for the Tribe.
They've got to give him something to cheer about, though, in this first half. Well,
they're moving here past midfield.
0 of 6 on third down. Need this one. Wilson throws. It's intercepted. Montana State. Simeon Woodard. Reversing field, takes it back to William and Mary territory. 30-yard return for Woodard.
Woodard, the sophomore, but four interceptions a season ago, has his first of the year. 24-0, Montana State.
It is all Bobcats here at Bozeman. Kevin, Dustin Fox, Jan Alder with you. Lauren Sisler down on the sidelines. Montana State has really separated themselves, Dustin, and they've got an opportunity to pour it on here at the end of the first half.
Yeah, it's been all Bobcats, like you say, Jay, and they've just done it on the ground mostly, just kind of enforcing their will, imposing their will. If you're watching this game, it's just been domination by this offensive line of Montana State.
And you feel for the Tribe defensively, because this defense has been on the field really all half long. Let's check in with Lauren.
Hot story. He's been on quite the journey, landing the nickname Tommy Touchdown. He started 9 games on kickoff returns last season, okay? Then he eventually got to run some Wildcat reps, built on more reps, and then in the last regular season game against Montana, he started as receiver. He then recalls his first quarterback start in the playoffs, the winds whipping at 40 miles per hour. He didn't have much experience, but he did his best, and he hasn't looked back since.
Yeah, that was UT Martin. He got his first start, and he said the winds were insane. Didn't have his best performance, but certainly taken off as a quarterback here at Montana State.
Completes the pass there. Robbie Alston on the reception. Well, he was a tough judge on himself. He played really well in those playoffs, led them all the way to the FCS championship game as a true freshman.
Yeah, I mean, in that game, it certainly got away from them early. He was injured, hurt his ankle on the opening drive of that ball game, and certainly hurt their chances to win that national championship.
Two minutes left in this first half. Malott looking for more. Tries a tuck and run, swallowed up at the line of scrimmage. Great stop by Nate Lynn. Two-time first-team All-CAA defensive end for this William & Mary team.
If you're William & Mary, you just try to get out of this final drive here before halftime with maybe minimizing the damage, as it's 24-0. Bobcats in no hurry.
Now they're up 24-0 at Montana State. We'll get the ball to start the third quarter as well. Malott slings it over the middle. It's caught, but not for much. Tommy's went right back to Alston. Timeout, Montana State. 64 seconds left in this first half. Gives us a chance to remind you, Monday Night Football in Week 14. Great matchup between the Patriots and Cardinals. Both teams trying to keep their playoff hopes alive. 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ESPN. The Manning cast will be back over on ESPN2 with Peyton and Eli. And, of course, our coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown at 6.
Well, let's take a look at what Tommy Malott's been able to accomplish here tonight, mostly with his legs. He's in the first quarter, quarterback sweep on the outside, and another quarterback sweep. It gets him inside the 30-yard line. Then they kind of bring in this package with Sean Chambers. Kind of a broken play. No problem. Another touchdown for Tommy Malott, having a great game here in the quarterfinals.
4 of 6 through the air for 72 yards on the ground. 49 yards of those 2 touchdowns. Grew up about 90 miles from here in Butte, America. Home to the richest hill on earth, the Copper Kings here in Montana, as Malott's tackled in the backfield. Nate Lynn again, he's made 2 huge stops here on this drive, trying to contain Montana State from adding to this 24-0 lead.
Well, Nate Lynn gets an assist from the turf. because Tommy Mellott steps back, and I think if he's able to actually plant that foot and take off, he may have picked up the first down, but instead they're going to lose 5 yards and force a long field goal attempt.
It's a big kick.
Long kick.
Blake Lesnar trying to knock one in from 50. He's got plenty of leg. Does he have the accuracy? Yes, he does. Glesner drills it. Wow. That would have been good from 55. Makes it 27-0, Cats.
Oh, we knew he had a leg, but you just wonder, you know, with the conditions and the teens, it's balmy. He's got all the leg. Nails this.
Look at where this lands.
That'd have been good for 55.
Yeah. Now Brent Vegan, head coach of Montana State, told us Blake Lesnar has all the leg in the world. We saw it there. It's just been the accuracy at points this season.
He did hit a 54-yarder last year against Idaho State, so you know he's got that leg.
He does the kickoffs as well, and everybody here at Montana State says it's shocking if he does not get a touchback. 2 for 2 tonight. Been strong throughout his sophomore campaign. 27-0 Montana State. Dustin,
a little surprised. Especially the way the game started. You know, William and Mary got a couple of stops, forced some three and outs. But boy, their offense just has been stifled.
I think the crowd has made a huge difference.
Everything's
tonight.
Made a difference. The home field advantage here, the crowd, the conditions. You know, these guys, they don't have an indoor facility yet. They're working on that, but they practice outside in these conditions every single day. So they're no stranger to this environment.
What an advantage that is. I mean,
huge.
I know you'd love to have an indoor facility. Brent Vegan joked with us that you better mention on the air that we're working on that indoor facility.
But you know what's so cool, though, is seeing the FCS playoffs and how you have the home field advantage throughout with the higher seed, of course. Now with the CFP expanding to 12 teams and having some home site games, I think it's going to be awesome to see at the FBS level what the FCS has been doing for quite some time.
Brent Vegan has never lost a game here in Bobcat Stadium since taking the job, a record that looks like it's going to remain intact tonight.
Well, unless there's... It's a miracle here with this offense. They can't get anything going.
Yoder still battling, pushing past the 30. You can't fault the effort from William and Mary in this first half. They've given it everything. But they will need a Herculean effort in this second half, down 27-0.
Couldn't have drawn up a better script for the Cats. Great defense, great offense, 27-0.
Back in Bozeman where it is all Montana State, 27-0 headed into the second half. That's where I would want to watch the game. The Heaters working in overdrive, 18 degrees outside as the clock is about to strike midnight on the East Coast. Ooh, first half stats tell the story, Dustin Fox.
How the Bobcats are up 27-0. Just look at the offensive stats, the lack of offensive production from William and Mary. Just 3 first downs in that first half. And the Bobcats are going to get the football here to start this second half, Jay. If William and Mary's going to get something going, they need a stop here right now or a turnover.
Montana State will start with the football. Remember, William and Mary won the toss and decided to receive. Through the first two drives, we thought it would be a defensive showdown. Both teams three and out. And then Montana State hit another gear. What's the recipe for a miraculous comeback for William and Mary, Dustin?
I think you need to score on defense. And you need to do it, like, right now. You got to start ball searching. Try to create a turnover here. And give yourself at least maybe good field position. Even a three and out.
Scooped up at the 5-yard line by Marquis Johnson. Steps on the gas, breaks a tackle. Nobody in front of him. It's a foot race. Johnson slips at the 15, falls inside the 10, But what a return. 87 yards.
Well, that's not going to help William and Mary. Goodness gracious. Just see the burst. Football inside the 5-yard line decides to bring it out. Doesn't really even get touched until about the 35-yard line. Great effort, though, by number 18, Amari Smith, the cornerback. Save a touchdown.
Just like that, into the red zone, first and goal. Montana State has picked up right where they left off in that first half. Isaiah Fonse breaks a tackle, bulldozes his way into the end zone. Touchdown, Montana State. They have laid the hammer down to start this third quarter.
Boy, talk about a perfect start to the second half. You get a kickoff return inside the 10-yard line, and then you bulldoze your way in for six.
20 seconds into the second half, Montana State reminding William and Mary that this game belongs to them. Let's get the flag that was thrown after the touchdown run.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, defense number 8. That 15-yard penalty we enforced on the kickoff.
What a night for Afonso. 11 carries, 162 yards, 2 touchdowns.
Man, you watch Afonso. Doesn't really get touched until about the goal line, and then takes Marcus Barnes for a ride into the end zone.
And we're speaking at halftime with a few Montana State fans. They reminded us Isaiah Afonso has another year of eligibility.
How about that?
Because he missed the entire regular season, even if they make it all the way to the championship, it would just be the 4th game. So he would get his redshirt year. Incredible. Let's check in with Lauren.
Yeah, guys, talking to Coach London coming out of locker room, obviously a lot of frustration. He says this is a hostile environment, but we've got to control the controllables, and that's something that he really had to talk to the team about and send that message, especially to his young quarterback, Darius Wilson, who really has had to kind of control his emotions out here. He said, look, we got to play in this hostile environment. You got to control yourself. You got to demonstrate to the rest of the team how you're controlling yourself, your emotions, and how to play the game. We've got to execute and get something going here in the second half.
Staying toasty down there, Lauren?
Ooh. I had to put some foot warmers in the little booties down here. The heated vest, though, is working well, my friends.
Lauren, do you think that the weather is affecting William and Mary?
I do. You know, I'll tell you. Kalen Newton came off the field, and, you know, he kind of had the headgear on, and it's like he was sweating but also freezing at the same time and trying to catch his breath. And it's just interesting watching these guys trying to stay warm, trying to stay loose, not be stiff. Yeah. And I think that's really what Coach Lund was talking about is, like, you know, it's a hostile environment. We came to this knowing it was going to be cold, but we've got to somehow find a spark. And I definitely think it's slippery out here. It's cold. And these elements are, it's very hard to prepare for this.
Well, I'll tell you this much. You know, when you're down 34-0, those hits, they start hurting a little bit more.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they're a long way away from Williamsburg, Virginia. And it feels longer when you're down 34-0, playing in 17 degrees. And
when you've got 3 first downs offensively and you can't get anything going with your ground attack that nearly, you know, averages about 275 a game, it's got to be extremely frustrating for Coach London and his staff. You know, they come in 4th in the FCS in rush yardage per game.
Shut out in that first half. A ground game that's served them so well all season. Set a school record for rushing yards. Totally shut down.
The loss of a yard of the play. Second down and 11.
And that's where I think, Dustin, you got nothing to lose. You're down 34-0. Let Darius Wilson just air it out the rest of this game, right?
I mean, you got to do something to try to get some points. Down 5 scores.
Play action. Wilson gets rid of it. Caught by Kalen Newton, younger brother of Cam Newton. His second reception of the night. Been very quiet, though, for the top target of the Tribe.
Now, when you talk about the conditions, right, and just in playing in these conditions, I have many times, adrenaline's kind of what keeps you going. Being down 34-0, you don't have that adrenaline. You don't have anything positive to rely upon.
To hang on.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly.
0-for-7 on third down. Wilson, happy feet, in trouble. Somehow escapes all the pressure, throws incomplete. Trey McDonald laid out for it. Couldn't catch it, though. And now, 4th and 8.
You can even see Wilson as he's just trying to get outside the pocket, trying to keep his footing. He had McDonald. It's going to be a night that Darius Wilson and these William and Mary players are going to want to forget.
Freshman Dowler from the 30. Big hit just past the 50. 20-yard return. And great field position again for Montana State. Not like they need it. Up 34-0 in this quarterfinal. Two kids having a snow fight as we welcome you back to Bozeman. The snow piled up here. Reminder, tomorrow, two terrific games on ESPN, college basketball, North Carolina, trying to break that four-game losing streak against Georgia Tech, and then Kansas, Missouri, 5:15 Eastern time, both games on ESPN tomorrow. The officials during our break taking a look at this for targeting.
Alex Washington, the backup linebackers on special teams. I think that's definitely targeting.
Crown of the helmet. Launch.
Textbook.
This should be a clear-cut targeting call. Alex Washington for William and Mary on Taco Dowler, the return man for Montana State. This is going to put South Dakota State or Holy Cross, whoever wins that game tomorrow, noontime on ESPN, on notice. They're going to be watching this game tonight thinking, whew, Montana State is going to be really tough to beat.
Well, they got their hands full with Holy Cross first. They better not be looking ahead because
The Crusaders
are coming.
Spectacular season out of the Patriot League. Let's get the call for targeting.
After review, number 34 for William and Mary committed targeting with the crown of the helmet. Number 34 is disqualified from the game. That 15-yard penalty will be enforced from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
We thought it was a clear-cut call, and the officials agreed.
Yeah, once you get that crown down,
yep.
It's a tough hit that Taco Dowler has to endure.
So Washington's night is done, and Montana State starts with excellent field position again at the 34-yard line.
Well, now you want to see what kind of fight William & Mary has defensively. You know, they just scored in 20 seconds. Now they've got the ball inside the 35 again. And you know there's going to be a steady dose of quarterback run and Infante.
It's Chambers. Let's check in with Lauren Sisler on the sideline.
Guys, I wanted to share a couple quick notes from Coach Vegan going into the locker room. He said defensively, we're holding him down, tackling well, lined up where we're supposed to be, putting pressure on the quarterback. He likes where things are coming together offensively. He also complimented special teams, which we're seeing right now firing on all cylinders here in the second half. But he said we can't rest on our laurels. But I'll tell you, this team's energized. They've been energized from jump, and it continues right into the second half.
And we talked yesterday with Coach Vegan. He talked about that third quarter, right? And that's where they're at.
Here's Chambers. turns the corner inside the 10, bounced out of bounds at the 2.
Great block by Derek Snell on the outside. And Jay, this third quarter has been cat time all year. They've outscored their opponents 78 points in the third quarter versus all FCS opponents, and they're just dominating right now. They can do anything they want against William and Mary, and you wonder at some point. I mean,
this defense is gassed.
They're gassed. They're just absolutely gassed.
They've been on the field
and you got Big
all
Cat,
night long.
Big Cat, Little Cat here.
Malott, Little Cat, Chambers, the bigger quarterback, the Big Cat. Tommy, touchdown, already with two scores today. Make it 3 for the sophomore from Butte.
Touchdown, Montana State.
Malott and Montana State pouring it on at home.
Just too easy. I don't know how you stop this Cats offense. This is supposed to be a pass to the flat. Not open, no problem. The hat trick for Tommy Malott.
Should we throw some cowboy hats down on the field?
Should have worn ours.
41-0, all Cats. The party is on at Bozeman in the NCAA FCS Championship coverage. Continue semifinal action next weekend on ESPN2. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Dustin Fox, Lauren Sisler, Jay Alter with you. Fun crowd here in Bozeman. The Friday night lights were on. This atmosphere has been awesome since before kickoff.
Domination basically since the third drive of the game for the Cats. And if you're a fan at this game and you're enjoying some libations here in Bozeman, trying to stay warm, well, beat up 41-0. That'll keep you warm,
yeah.
Right?
What about the entrance? You had the Bobcats rodeo team riding in, number one team in the nation in rodeo. And that's a fact, by the way. The women's team is the number one rodeo team in the country.
It's a deep dive you did in your
prep
there, bud.
Yeah. Flags flying. And little pushing and shoving at the 20-yard line. Tempers flaring. This is where frustration really comes in for William and Mary. You realize your season is coming to an end.
The result of a play was a touchback. Dead ball, personal foul, late hit. Return team number 16. Pelley's half distance to the goal, first and 10.
So tough to keep a cool head when you're trailing 41-0 on the road. Let's check in with Lauren.
Yo, guys, you talk about the fans getting into it. Well, they've been getting into it. We've been dancing down here on the sidelines together, getting after it. Woo!
Got the sideline shimmy, Lauren?
Got the sideline shimmy. Let's go. Y'all, they're fun. These guys are having fun. It don't matter how cold it is out here.
Oh, you got to do something down there to stay warm, right?
It's rough, man.
You would never know. It's 17 degrees looking at Lauren Sisler. Meanwhile, you and I.
Cozy up here. We've got
nice, warm, heated booth while Lauren freezes. You would never know it. How much excitement and enthusiasm.
I think Lauren learned her lesson from earlier this year. We had the
Purdue-Illinois
game,
yeah,
in Champaign, one of the coldest games, and Lauren was a little underprepared for that one.
Yeah, Lauren's a Birmingham, Alabama native, or lives there currently, or originally from Virginia, where, yeah, William and Mary, obviously from the state of Virginia. They've been bundled up. I think it's been a little bit of a weather shock for this Tribe team.
Oh, I think so.
We were told yesterday this is the coldest game they've ever played in the school's history.
Yoder with the run, Callahan O'Reilly with the stop.
And this is a history, obviously not football history, but a school history that is rich. Founded in 1693 by King William and Queen Mary of England, second oldest academic institution in the country. It was described to me this week the biggest game in program history, coming out here for a FCS quarterfinal, and they have taken shot after shot. Down 41-0, a third and eight. Wilson rolling left, surveying the field, heaves it, incomplete, tipped in the secondary. Great coverage. Ryland Ort coming over to make the third down swat. More of the same for Montana State, Dustin.
Yeah, they're playing with an energy right now, and again, you can just see William and Mary, especially in the trenches, they're feeling these conditions. Oh, heck of a punt.
Dowler running back from the 20, turns up field, makes a few men miss, steps on the gas and tripped up just shy of the 50. I'll tell you what, this Cat special team unit has come to play.
Taco Dowler, how does he make this play? This is putted over his head out of 15 yards, and he ends up getting it out near midfield. Incredible. All Cats from Bozeman.
All Montana State here in this FCS quarterfinal. They look likely to join North Dakota State in the semifinals. The Bison won earlier. Incarnate Word right now, pulling a little bit of an upset on Sacramento State, and then South Dakota State Holy Cross tomorrow, noon Eastern time on ESPN.
That would be a big upset there on the road.
Well, the Bobcats offense, one of the best in FCS. They play with two quarterbacks who are both on the field right now. Sean Chambers, one of them, took that for 4 yards. You know, a lot of teams will play or say they play with a two-quarterback system. One's usually a passer. One's more of a thrower. Very rarely they play on the field at the exact same time, and that's what Chambers and Malott will do, although Chambers running off here before the second and six. How difficult is that to scout, Dustin?
Especially when they're both on the field, because they can run all sorts of trick plays. They can hand the football off to one another. I mean, there's just so many different variations to this offense.
Speaking with Tommy Malott yesterday, he said we had a nice selfless quarterback competition. I go, selfless and competition don't really go together, but with these two guys, they really do, right, Lauren?
Yeah, and adding to that, Jay, it was interesting because he said my goal was to help the team. Sean's goal is to help the team. It's selfless competition, as you said. We care about the team, the program, our family, and friends. This is much bigger than us. And it's really cool to see as a young quarterback to be able to be humble like that. And then for Sean to come in, obviously, with his career wanting to make an impact and being able to humble himself and say, look, I'm going to do what it takes to contribute. Selfless competition. That's a new one. I like it.
Dustin, as a former player, is there such a thing as selfless competition?
Well, I think that there can be. And I would say this, too. You know, talking with these kids yesterday, it was refreshing. You know, with so much of the talk of NIL with FPS and FBS and things like that, these kids, like, really love one another. They love Bozeman. They love Montana State. They love their teammates, the coaches. Like, it was just awesome to hear these guys talk about how much they love this program.
They check their ego at the door each and every day.
I don't think there is an ego. How can you have an ego?
They're here to win an FCS championship, become national champions. They were in the game a year ago in Brent Vegan's first year, now trying to get over the hump. And boy, have they shown that today. They have come out with a point to prove. 41-0 with still 8 minutes left to this third quarter. Malott takes a shot to the end zone. It's caught. Another Bobcat touchdown. Cleveland Thomas on the end of a beautiful ball by Tommy Malott. His first passing touchdown of the night to go along with three rushing touchdowns.
Just an incredible touch on this throw on the outside by Tommy Malott, just adding to his monster day. It was pool and coverage. Great job by Thomas, his third touchdown of the year. At some point, Montana State, you think they take the foot off the gas? They're just...
I don't know if they know how.
That's a good point.
Really, talking to those guys, they'll take their foot off the gas after they've hoisted that trophy. Yeah. There's another flag down after the...
Number 35, his first of the ball game. And that 15-yard penalty to be enforced on the kickoff.
Unsportsmanlike conducts are starting to pile up for William & Mary. Clearly frustration just pouring in for the Tribe. They know that their season is coming to an end. You feel bad for Mike London and this William & Mary team because they picked up a bad night to have their worst game of the season. This is a team that's got a school record, 11 wins, tremendous success, and that doesn't get diminished just because you go on the road and lose a quarterfinal. Still an outstanding season that this team has had. They just have not played nearly their best tonight.
No, and you come in here and you don't play your best football, you're going to run into a buzzsaw. And that's exactly what happened here tonight against Montana State. Now you're just like, where's the hot cocoa?
There's still a lot of game left. Now, 8 minutes left of this third quarter.
And like you said, Montana State, they really don't know how to take their foot off the gas. So if William & Mary doesn't do something to get a couple first downs, they're going to keep running the score up.
You know, there's a great football history at William & Mary as more flags come out.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number 19 in the kicking team. A 15-yard penalty will be administered from the end of the run, automatic, first down.
Mike London was telling us yesterday that William & Mary holds a special place at his heart. It was his first full-time coaching opportunity. Coached the D-line from 1991 to 1994. Helped recruit two guys to the Tribe during his time there. You might have heard of them. Mike Tomlin and Sean McDermott, two current NFL head coaches.
Yeah, it's funny, I played for both of them. Coach Tomlin was my defensive coordinator with the Vikings, and Sean McDermott was my secondary coach when I was with the Philadelphia Eagles. No surprise, both of them terrific head coaches in the National Football League.
And they got their start playing football for this William & Mary program. You know, I went down the rabbit hole a little bit. It's very rare that you would find two NFL head coaches to come out of an FCS program. They're the only two currently being head coaches in the NFL right now to come out of an FCS program. To have two in the NFL at the same time, remarkable. Wilson in trouble like he's been in all night. Another incompletion. It's not just Tomlin and McDermott, William & Mary, current players in the NFL. DeAndre Houston Carson, a safety for the Bears. He's the notable name of those three. Bronson Yoder spinning out of a tackle, hard running all night long. Brings up fourth and one. Offense is going to stay on the field.
Give it to Yoder. Yoder's running hard at this point.
Wilson goes right under center. Montana State loading the box. Needs a yard. Gets it.
Ty Okada, after the play, just throws Yoder off the pile. I'm surprised they didn't call something there. You see seven come in here off the outside. Oh, he takes a little shot first.
You think Okada has a chance at the next level, Dustin?
I'll tell you what, it's a good question. He is just a terrific safety slash hybrid. But I think a guy like him, I think he's got a chance to play special teams in the NFL and could play a long time. Seriously.
Yeah. Speaking with the coaching staff, just huge football IQ. Just makes plays, never out of position. He's going to do exactly what you need him to do. And they thought, at least head coach Brent Vegan thought, if he can just get on to a training camp, he'll prove it.
I guarantee he makes a roster.
Yeah. Wilson.
Guess who?
Down he goes. Right on cue. Ty Okada delivers.
Great when TV works out for you. Ty Okada, we're just talking about him. He comes inside on a blitz. What a day he's had. Four tackles, a tackle for loss, a PBU, a quarterback hit, and now a sack.
And he's the quarterback in the defense. He gets the play from the sideline, feeds it to the rest of the group.
You know, we do the Foxhole segment every game where we pick a player. It's like, I don't know who to pick from Montana State right now. I think we got a leader in the clubhouse, though.
You going Tommy touchdown or Okada?
Can't tell you yet.
You won't tell me who you voted the Heisman?
No, it's
now
a secret.
You're not telling me who you're putting in the foxhole. Can't get anything up here.
I'll tell you later.
That's the type of night it's been for Darius Wilson and William and Mary. Has this been more about William and Mary underperforming or Montana State overperforming?
I think it's a little bit of both. You know, Montana State got off to that great start, and I think they just kind of put William and Mary in a tough spot, especially defensively, because the amount of reps, the amount of plays that they were on the field.
Ninth punt of the night. Here's Taco Dowler. Steps on the gas, and he's gone. 80-yard punt return. The freshman has put the Bobcats to 54 points on the night.
Well, if nobody's going to tackle him, might as well punt it out of bounds. Goodness gracious. Untouched.
The last couple of returns, he showed how dangerous he could be. That one finally broken loose for the 80-yard punt return. What a night for Montana State.
Jay, Montana State has just scored 31 points in less than 10 minutes. Just incredible. Look at this hole right up the middle. Some good blocks. And it shows off the speed at the end. Unbelievable.
A lot of Cat fans would tell you that their best performance of the season came on November 19th against their in-state rival, Montana, where they hung 55 points on the Grizz. That game means so much. Your College Game Day was here for it on November 19th. They've already hit that 55 number, and they've done it in the third quarter with 5:03 left.
Just scored 31 points in 10 minutes.
It's crazy. And winning that Cat Grizz game, that's a big deal.
Oh, yeah.
But now they've got their sights set on a national championship.
At this point, now you're focusing on
keeping everybody healthy, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, at this point, maybe you get some of the backups in the game.
Especially with those slippery field conditions we've seen, I would get every
get everybody out of this game as healthy as you possibly can.
Let's go down and check in with Lauren.
Yeah, you guys hit on the exact question I was just asking. 5:03 left in the third quarter. Your starters are still in. You're up 55-0. When do you take your foot off the gas? And talking to Coach Vegan yesterday, he talked about you really have to zoom out on the big picture in December. Even in the summer workouts, you have to take a run in December into consideration. Week 8, they had a bye, which was a good reset for them. Of course, the bye going into the playoffs helps. But really, by week 9 of the season, they started backing off with full contact practices, became more walkthrough-oriented. He also said this is when you really value the scout team and getting the younger guys reps. So it'll be interesting to see how they shake things up here heading into the fourth quarter.
You know, Lauren mentions the summer. And the guys told us losing in that national championship game a year ago. They wanted to add another banner. There's three of them flying in the wind here tonight over Bobcat Stadium. The last one coming in 1984. They said when they were working out in the summer, they would climb hills. And after the 15th hill, guys are getting winded. So they hold up a sign. Remember that national championship game. And that 16th hill was the fastest of them all. Because that was what was motivating them all summer long. When they were out of breath, they got a boost. And they certainly have a big boost tonight. Trickery snuffed out. Bobcats haven't been fooled all night long. Zach Black on the tackle.
Just trying to do anything if you're William and Mary. And the Bobcats are just everywhere. They're just flying around, pumped up, excited. 55-0. I mean, my goodness.
Hey, Dustin, you won a national championship with Ohio State. Do you see the same look in the eye? I mean, this is a team that...
I saw a look in the players' eyes yesterday when we chatted with their quarterbacks and a couple of their star defensive players. Yeah, they seem ready for this journey. They want to get back.
Wilson's plan is complete.
And when you have something like that motivating you all summer long, Brent Vegan told us the workouts are that much harder. He just felt like all offseason, all season long, they were building towards one thing, and that was to end with a win, with a national championship.
You ready for another touchdown?
Taco Dowler touchdown. On the last punt return, he took it 80 yards.
I would not punt the football to 14.
This is the 10th punt of the night for William and Mary. And they're going to give Dowler a chance. Trying to find the hole, one does not appear.
Taco Dowler right
there. There is a flag down at the 20-yard line.
Right down to number 81 to 35.
During the kick, holding receiving team number 17. By rule, that penalty will be enforced 10 yards from the end of the kick. First down, Montana State.
And it's still Sean Chambers in there for Montana State. Thought maybe we'd see the redshirt freshman Sean Austin come in with this game well out of hand. Chambers throwing, connecting. Coy Steele up 55-0 and throwing the football in this third quarter.
Yeah, I can't imagine Coach London's too happy. They're taking shots still here, up 55-0. You said it, not taking the foot off the gas.
Frustrating night for Mike London. It's a tough way to end your season, a season that has had so many bright spots. Colonial champs, 11 wins, ties the school record. But they have come on the road to Bozeman, and Montana State has just run all over them. Now, William and Mary thought the ball might have popped out at the end of that run. Malone has it for the Tribe in his hands.
And the White Hats coming in here to have a little conversation. Maybe they're going to take a look at this one.
The ruling on the field was a fumble recovered by William and Mary.
Oh, wow.
First and 10, William and Mary.
Oh, that's quick.
That's a turnover. Okay. Not even going to take a look at it. William and Mary football.
Yeah, watch as Chambers is just fighting here for the extra yardage. It's hard to tell. I mean, the ball clearly recovered by Mike Malone, 95.
You wonder how this game is different if the interception stood for William and Mary. Instead, it was waved off for defensive pass interference. Montana State then scores to make it 24-0.
I don't think anything's going to change this game, partner.
That is true. Certainly the result has not been in question. Really the first hole that Bronson Yoder has found tonight.
It's a good run, though. He's still fighting.
Yoder with the run.
He had more than 1,000 yards on the ground this season. He's been bottled up all night long. Took that one for 26. Not many times William and Mary have been in Bobcat territory. Yoder, hard running. You would never know. They're down 55-0 looking at the way Bronson Yoder is running the football on this drive.
No, he's running tough. He's fighting. Just keep giving the ball to number 9. Oh, he's bottled up quickly. Kyle Rigg, 93, was the first to get in there.
Third quarter winding down. William and Mary trying to end the scoreless streak here in Bozeman.
It may just go to the fourth quarter, Jay.
Yeah. Now they've put together their best drive of the game, albeit against backups on defense for Montana State. No question who's moving on to the semifinals. The Bobcats have been the better team through three quarters tonight. Back in Bozeman, start of the fourth quarter. Fenway Park West, Sweet Caroline playing to start the fourth quarter. This crowd is fired up, shirtless in 15-degree weather. Why not? Your team's up 55-0.
Just amazing. It's like 15 degrees, and the crowd is still here rocking.
This is what college football is all about.
I love this, and we've had such a great time in Bozeman. Shout out to all the great people here who took such great care of us.
Western Cafe for breakfast this morning.
Cafe. That place
Susan,
is amazing.
Tremendous.
Tremendous.
And the heaters will keep you warm, so will 55 points.
Did you like that, the Bobcat French toast?
I did.
That was solid.
That was really, really good. 17 degrees, but it feels like 7. 10:45 local time. This Bobcats defense unrelenting. Ears pinned back on a 3rd and 12, trying to keep the shutout alive. Wilson buys time now, scoots off. Sets up a 4th and manageable.
Here's Wilson with the run. He's chased back down by number 57.
Yeah, I think it's easy to talk about how amazing the atmosphere is before kick. The rodeo crew's coming out, it's awesome. 55-0. It feels like 7 degrees. A lot of people would say, all right, let's go home and watch the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
You know, they're not leaving. They're fired up. They're celebrating. The party is on in Bozeman.
They'd be making their way to Main Street at this point. They're staying here at Bobcat Stadium.
Is that where we're headed?
Crystals?
You tell me. 4th and 3. Wilson fires, incomplete. It was tipped.
Wilson's pass is incomplete.
And it's looking very likely that William and Mary may leave Bozeman with no points to their name. Oh, it is all Montana State. The party on the sidelines. NCAA FCS championship coverage continues with our semifinal next weekend on ESPN2. For more information, visit NCAA.com, the home for all 90 NCAA championships. Sean Austin into the game. Third string quarterback for Montana State. Flag down after the completed pass. Austin, the redshirt freshman, out of Idaho.
Ineligible receiver, number 72 for the offense, illegally downfield. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot, first down.
I saw Champ, the mascot, roaming the sidelines. Reminded me when Lee Corso on November 19th, he threw on the Bobcat head at the end of college game day. Sir Nick Faldo, Bozeman resident, was the guest picker that day. I loved what he said. All the guys bundled up. They had their gloves on. He was like,
making fun of,
no gloves. Yeah. No gloves here, Herbie. Lauren, what's going on down there?
Guys, I wanted to share a pretty cool moment with you. Number 9 on the field right now, Carl Fowler, just walked over from William & Mary and just said thank you. I had the opportunity to talk with him this week, and what a bright young man. This is a young man that's going to graduate from law school this May, aspires to be a public defender. He told me his eyes were really open to that when he went to a civil rights education tour to Alabama one summer. It was called Honestly Remembering Together. He saw firsthand that a large segment of America was being cast aside and sees himself really fitting in there and being able to make a difference. And, you know, I just, for him to walk over middle of a football game, they're down 55-0, to just thank me for the opportunity to just cover the team in the way that we've covered William & Mary this week, says a lot about the character of this football team and Carl Fowler himself.
That's great stuff, Lauren. Speaks volumes about that young man's character.
Yeah, I think any student athlete, the three-time captain in law school right now while playing a Division I sport, incredible. Has not been Fowler or anybody in White's night. You got a third string running back, third string quarterback in for Montana State, Garrett Kuhn and Sean Austin. Kuhn on the carry.
It doesn't matter who you give the football to here for Montana State. They're just gashing them still.
Yeah, an offensive line that Brent Vegan just couldn't say enough good things about. You know, I think the one guy up front that just personifies the team, Justice Perkins, the sophomore center, Bozeman native, grew up a second-generation Cat. His father, Josh, played at Montana State. Undersized, just 6 foot. A lot of people said he can't play offensive line at 6 foot. He has proved them wrong. Anchors an outstanding offensive line.
What you got, Lauren?
Yeah, just adding on what you said about Justice, size-wise, didn't know what he could do here, but he bet on himself when he came here, matched his work ethic with his belief in himself. Cole Sain at the starting spot, he went down. Justice took advantage of it and hasn't moved since. He's confident yet humble and has earned the right to be front and center.
Well, he's out of the game right now. They've put in the second string offensive line, Holden Sampson at center, but Perkins for three quarters, a stalwart. And what does it say that your backup offensive line
seven yards,
just as good of a push as your starting unit?
Well, I think it just speaks volumes to the depth that the Cats have, and certainly, you know, so many players coming back for another season. And their offensive line, all young underclassmen. You talked about it, J2, Isaiah Ifonse has another year. Imagine he gets 100% healthy.
So many guys coming back, but they're not thinking of next year, Dustin. They're thinking about finishing strong now, then the semifinal against South Dakota State or Holy Cross, and then maybe a rematch with the Bison.
It's possible. It's certainly possible. You and I were watching some of that game before our game kicked off. Bison looking stout as always.
If you want to win an FCS championship, chances are you have to go through North Dakota State at some point. It was funny. I was reading on Twitter today that there's a group of FCS schools that want to join together, about 10 of them, to create a new conference and bump up into FBS football. And somebody replied, if they want to do that, that's fine. They should all be required to beat North Dakota State before you leave. You can't bump up from FCS to FBS unless you can beat North Dakota State.
You see the Bison already through.
Got to do
a heck of a game over on Plus. Kernet Word up 28-24.
Got to do a game at the Fargo Dome when Trey Lance was quarterback. And I asked them, would you guys ever want to bump up to FBS? And they go, no, we're perfectly happy winning a national
just
championship
dominating
every season. Yeah. Life's pretty good here.
Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Fourth down.
I don't care what level of football you're talking about. When you see an effort like this, where you have executed a game plan to perfection, put yourself up 55-0, it's incredible to watch.
Well, and think about this. If you're South Dakota State or Holy Cross, sitting around your hotel room, getting ready for bed. Well, you're probably sleeping at this point. Trying to think. Yeah, you're probably in bed at this point, but you're looking at the score when you wake up in the morning, and you're just like, goodness gracious. That's what lies ahead.
That game, noon Eastern time on ESPN tomorrow as the FCS quarterfinals continue on ESPN. Tomorrow afternoon on ABC, college basketball doubleheader starts with an old Big East rivalry. Patrick Ewing at Georgetown taking on Jim Boeheim at Syracuse at 1 Eastern. And then if you have not watched Houston play, you're going to want to watch tomorrow. Top 10 matchup at 3 Eastern time. There's Lauren Sisler, our sideline reporter, talking with Champ
the Bobcat.
She's always
making friends with the mascots.
That mascot Champ better watch out soon. She's gonna ask him to start dancing over on the sideline.
She made friends with Cosmo out at BYU earlier this year, doing the shimmy on the sidelines.
Not a lot of dancing for William and Mary tonight. What's your favorite dance move?
I don't have any dance moves.
The foxtrot. Oh, there it is. Tip your waitress.
We're at that point in the game?
We are.
Let's see Lauren dancing.
Oh, there it is.
What is this move?
Oh,
is that the
Soldier Boy?
Soldier Boy. That's old school.
Yeah.
It's a throwback.
Champ, get low. Oh, drop it low, Champ.
Love it.
Oh, that is incredible.
Lauren's got enough content now for social media for like the next 3 months.
The entire offseason.
Yeah, covered.
Exactly. Have you, in your career, been on the receiving end of a beatdown? And how do you keep yourself motivated?
The last game, my sophomore year of high school, I was at Canton Glen Oak. We lost to Massillon Perry 63-0.
So you've experienced
I've been on the side of this. Yeah. And guess what? I still remember it. I was thinking about that game. I mean, I was 16 years old.
And stays with you.
You don't forget it.
We complimented so well that the game plan went to perfection for Montana State all night long. Just the opposite for William & Mary, a game plan all week. You feel really good. We speak with the coaches, the players. They came in feeling like they could win this game and gets away from you early, unravels the element certainly against you coming all the way from Virginia. A long flight back to Virginia for this Tribe team.
I think they'll just be happy they've got heat on the plane.
Yeah, true. Oh, of 13 on third down, that says it all. Very difficult way to end your season, especially a season that's been as successful tied a school record with 11 wins. That's the play of the day. On the run, great completion. JT Mayo with the grab to move the chains on third down for the first time tonight.
What a throw by Darius Wilson. Gets outside the pocket. The southpaw.
Inadvertently fell out of the line judge's pocket.
Mike London's team just trying to leave with some points. 5:30 left in regulation. Montana State has taken all the starters out of this game. There's a timeout down on the field. Injured William and Mary player. And we'll step aside.
Guess who? Isaiah Ifanse, he's back from injury. His first game of the season was a week ago, had 10 carries for 91 yards. Today, he breaks a school record for career yardage, has 11 carries and a 162 and a couple of touchdowns.
You know, you do it each week, Dustin, but not every week. The guy going into the foxhole sets history.
Incredible job by Ifanse. This guy has fought through so much adversity throughout his career the last three seasons. And just coming on at the right time for the Cats here as they approach the semifinals.
If you missed the story earlier, Isaiah Ifanse missed the entire regular season, came back last week against Weber State. This is only his second game. He now has 3,690 career rushing yards, the most in Bobcat history. Yoder picks up the first down and more, barreling over the secondary. William and Mary,
Yoder with
first and goal for the first time today, trying to lead with some points. Take something with them back to Virginia.
Talk about tough running. Yoder, he'd be a foxhole guy. Not giving up, down 55-0, just running dudes over. That's Caden Dowler. 17.
Upended before Yoder could break the plane.
Yoder with the run.
Going back to Ifanse, Dustin.
Yeah.
A lot of running backs this time of the season, December, they're banged up. They're hurt. Ifanse's fresh.
He just started practicing, you know, like in middle of November.
Woo. That could be the secret sauce to put Montana State over the top. And what a great story that would be, just to never doubt yourself. Rehabbing was hard, watching his team play without him. Now he's back, trying to push them over the top for a championship. Yoder stayed up. And William and Mary at least take some points with them. Back to Virginia. Bronson Yoder has had a terrific season for this Tribe team. That's now his 13th touchdown of the year.
A heck of a career for Yoder. Nice to see him get some points. He was running hard. Down 55-0. Somehow gets 122 yards on the night. Tough earned yards and a tough earned touchdown.
.311 left, Montana State. They're moving on to the semifinals. William and Mary on the board with .311 left. How about that? It feels like 7 degrees here in Bozeman.
Yeah. How do you have your shirts off?
And they are shirtless. At least if I was shirtless in Bozeman, there'd be some hair on the chest to keep me warm.
No gloves.
Nothing.
It's gracious to be young again.
Maybe a beverage or two to keep you warm, right? Over the course of the evening.
There's something warm.
Plenty to be excited about if you're a Montana State fan. 454 total yards. That wasn't just for the cameras, folks. They're staying shirtless for the remainder of this game. 9.5 yards per play. Just a night of total domination by the Cats. Got up 55-0, pulled all the starters. William and Mary, a consolation touchdown. We were here since Wednesday. You're staying an extra day. I'll tell you what, yeah. Bozeman won me over.
Bozeman might be one of my favorite towns in America. This place is awesome.
Went into Carter's, got ourselves some cowboy hats.
We did.
You chickened out on the boots, though.
I don't have $500 to spend.
Oh, no. We've got an official down. I believe that's Andrew Special, our head referee. It is. Nice to see him pop back up. That's the thing. You can take out the starters, but you can't take out the referees.
Look at the...
Oh, no.
Well, that's a tough shot.
Yo, it's basketball season, Dustin. That's a charge. Going the other way. Feet set.
Outside the restricted area?
Yes. So Montana State moving on to the semifinal. They'll get the winner of South Dakota State, Holy Cross. That game is tomorrow on ESPN, noon Eastern time. You're really high on the Jackrabbits.
I like that program, what they've done. They've just kind of been knocking on the door for a long time. Did a playoff game out in Brookings about 4 years ago, and I fell in love with that town, too.
You fall in love very easily.
I do.
with towns. With,
yes, yes. With towns.
Let me clarify. Everywhere we go, you're like, this is the best place ever.
I'm all about finding the best spots to eat.
You do a very good job of that.
And Lauren is always like,
she's the foodie.
She's the foodie. Dad, I don't know how she eats so much.
I had to get in on this conversation, y'all.
Jump on in.
Are you done dancing down there?
Dude, that's the only way I can stay warm. But let me tell you, that is one thing I told Dustin last night. Remember at dinner, I said, that is one thing that has been the highlight of this season, is I've got people that love food just as much as me. And every time we pick a restaurant, I look at the menu, I decide what I'm going to order. We get like 10 appetizers. You know me,
I love
buffets.
And then you ask the server a million questions, and you're already prepared.
Yep.
Well, I know, and I think I'm prepared, but then I second guess myself. But you guys know my love for buffets, so when we can order 20 things, why settle for one when you can have it all?
Well, this has been an all-you-can-eat buffet for Montana State
tonight.
It has been.
Well, this Montana State team, to me, looks like a juggernaut. And I think that they're going to be a team to beat here as we go. And obviously we'll see what happens tomorrow with South Dakota State and Holy Cross. But, man, this team, they look legit.
Brent Vegan in only year number two. He has brought this program to the top. Went to the national championship game a year ago. Cats could be well on their way back to that game. They left no doubt tonight. Convincing win, wire to wire.
I do want to say this about William & Mary and give Mike London a lot of credit, because they've had a terrific season. And they just ran into a buzzsaw today against a better football team in really tough conditions. And obviously it's a game that you're going to want to forget if you're a fan of the Tribe or a player, but they've had a tremendous season.
One that will be remembered and cherish. It's tough to think of it tonight when you lose in this fashion, but a huge successful season for William and Mary, even though the season ends tonight. Montana State moving on to that semifinal. Will it be South Dakota State? Will it be Holy Cross? We'll find out tomorrow, noon Eastern time on ESPN. By the way, you should head to ESPN Plus right now. Tied at 31. Let's catch that finish, Foxy. Terrific crew here in Bozeman. We thank everybody for braving the elements, our camera crew, our terrific production crew in the truck. Dustin Fox, Lauren Sisler, Jay Alter saying so long from Bozeman. The Montana State Bobcats moving on to the semifinals.